Bienvenidos a España. This past May, 18 students traveled across the Atlantic to Spain to study Spanish language and culture. One of the coolest things about Spain is the fact that for several centuries, the three major religions of the world, Christianity, Judaism, and the Muslim faith, lived together in peace. Students got to learn about this and much more as they spent a month studying and traveling to this beautiful country.
We were able to stay in homestays while we were in Madrid and Alicante. In these homestays, we only spoke Spanish. Our homestay families were native Spanish speakers, and it was an incredible opportunity for growth to be challenged at all hours of the day. Personally, for me, it was quite a shock going from Spanish 104, the first level of Spanish, into a completely Spanish household. But over time, it became much easier to understand and communicate. By the end of our homestays and our classes in Spain, Spanish became natural to understand, and I even caught myself thinking in Spanish a few times.
I like to compare the Spanish way of life to a three-course meal. The Spaniards see each new day as a delicious adventure to enjoy and to relish. Food is a way to bring people together and to spend quality time having meaningful conversations with family and friends. Our señora, a lively and eccentric woman named Julia, couldn't wait for us to come home and tell her about our day. We talked history, politics, art, fashion, and food over a steaming bowl of paella, a simple yet sinfully tasty rice dish embellished with meats and vegetables. In our homestay, bread was served at every meal along with garden salads, flavorful soups, and fresh fruits for dessert. For breakfast, it became routine to stop by the quaint little bakery outside of school to enjoy a piping hot cup of café con leche and a yummy pastry. Then we would finish our long day of exhausting excursions with a trip to San Ginés, a chocolateria in the heart of Madrid. The shop served you a plate of enormous churros and a mug of rich chocolate dipping sauce. Muy rico, ¿no? Food is a way of life in Spain, and it makes up the country's vibrant culture. I hope I get to go back for seconds someday soon.
Some afternoons, following language classes and cultural excursions in Madrid, students would have free time which they spent in a variety of ways. From strolling along the avenues of Madrid's main streets to visiting our favorite gelato stores, there was always something to do in this beautiful city. One of the locations that quickly became a favorite of the students was the Parque de Buen Retiro, which was located just a few minutes away from the Estudio San Pere. This park used to be the Royal Park before it was opened to the public when Spain became a democracy. Beautiful fountains and pools are encircled by acres of trimmed hedges and marble statues. A tennis court, running paths, and a rose garden were also in the park along with exercise equipment. Students even saw an engagement one afternoon on the pool that is in the center of the park.
One of the largest cultural events that we attended was the celebration of Madrid's patron saint, San Isidro. This festival is a religious celebration, so most individuals didn't have to work or go to school. After a very crowded metro ride, we arrived at the festival. We were greeted by long streets filled with vendors selling traditional food, trinkets, and many tasty treats. Surrounding these streets were grassy hills filled with families celebrating the holiday. Spaniards of all ages were dressed in traditional outfits with long, flowing skirts, red flowers, and flat hats. There were also many performers entertaining the crowds. One of the dances that was performed was the chotis, which is a traditional Spanish dance.
When we arrived in Spain, we had no idea how important soccer, or football, is to Spanish life. While watching the news with our homestay families, we were surprised to see how much of the program was focused on football. It seemed like football was more important than the upcoming elections. One of the most exciting nights in Madrid was getting to watch a soccer game in local sports bars between two teams from Madrid, Real Madrid and Atletico. After Real Madrid won the game, the entire city flooded the streets. There was a massive celebration in one of the plazas, complete with strobe lights, coming from a stage with a DJ booth that had been set up in the street. Everyone was singing, Campeones, or Champions, and dancing to Spanish and American music. It was midnight and people were still pouring out of the metros trying to get to the celebration, even families with little children. This was one of my favorite nights because it showed me how passionate Spaniards are about football.
Another cultural experience we had was the bullfight. About half of us went, mostly because we felt it was an important cultural experience. Bullfighting is definitely a hot topic in Spain. The Spanish population, which is traditionally entrenched in and proud of Spanish culture, is divided between those who believe bullfighting is outdated and cruel, and those who see it as an art form, a symbol of man's dominion over the beast. We found that those who hope to end bullfighting are of Spain's younger generation, and given this movement, the question we often asked ourselves is how long the tradition of bullfighting will survive in Spain. Additionally, we visited some museums. The museums in Spain are filled with art that illustrates the country's rich, complex history. We discovered that historically, many of the most famous Spanish artists used their art as an outlet to express their political opinions and anguish, as well as the thorough documentation of the Spanish monarchies. The Reina Sofía is a museum filled with modern works by artists such as Goya and Picasso. The Museo del Prado, the main Spanish national art museum, features a large collection of European art dating from the 12th century to the early 19th century. The museum is based upon the former Spanish royal collection and is considered the best single collection of Spanish art. During our second week in Madrid, we visited the Palacio Real, the official residence of Spanish royalty, which today is used only for ceremonial purposes. The palace is an astonishing 1,450,000 square feet and 3,418 rooms of splendor and luxury. Nearly every surface we saw was covered with gold leaf, plush velvet, marble, rare stones, or vibrant frescoes. To our surprise, we learned that it was the largest palace in Western Europe and was built on the site of the old Alcazar, a Moorish castle destroyed by fire in 1734.
On our way from Madrid to Sevilla, we stopped in Córdoba to visit the Mezquita. This mosque and cathedral is one of the best examples of cultures coming together that we saw on the trip. The mosque was built in 987 AD by the Moors. It was built on the ruins of an old Roman temple, and the rounded arch that features prominently in the design of the mosque started with the Romans. When the Moors lost control of Spain and the Catholics took over, the Islamic mosque was partially converted into a Catholic cathedral. When the cathedral was built, the Moorish architecture was so beautiful that the builders left as much of the mosque as possible. As a result, the cathedral is right in the middle of the mosque with its huge altar covered in gold and high vaulted ceilings. It was incredible to see the contrast between religions so perfectly blended in the same space.
One of the focuses of our abroad was the religions that have dominated Spain throughout its history. Islam and Christianity have taken turns being in control of the country, and during our week of travels around southern Spain, we looked at the historical, religious, and architectural influences of each religion. The first stop on our trip in Sevilla was the Iglesia de Santa María Magdalena, one of the most important churches in the city. This Baroque-style church has wonderful paintings by Lucas Valdés, an artist during the period. The interior design is a magnificent dome full of sculptures and carved images and intricate walls and arches. In Sevilla, we visited the Cathedral of St. Mary. It is the largest Gothic cathedral in Spain and the third largest church in the world, with 80 separate chapels, not counting the main nave. The cathedral was built in the 16th century in the Gothic style on the remains of an Islamic mosque. The call to prayer tower, now called La Giralda, was converted into a watchtower when the Christians took over and built their cathedral. This is one of the best examples of how the cultures in Spain have mixed to create a rich society with influences from around the world.
While we were at the cathedral, we had a brief history lesson on the Spanish settlers that followed Columbus to the New World. The city is located on a river plain and has historically been a port city. When Columbus and those that followed him left for the New World, they left from Sevilla. Because of their fame as a port city and the start of Columbus's voyage, Sevilla boasts that their cathedral is home to the tomb that supposedly holds the remains of Christopher Columbus. Next on our list was the Alcázar, a royal palace built by the Moors. This palace is one of the oldest palaces in the world. The Alcázar has lasted through the different invasions of each of the cultures and has still maintained its architectural style. The Moors who built the Alcázar were later called the Mudéjares, Muslims who remained in Spain after it had been reconquered by the Christians. The overall architecture of the Alcázar has Islamic influence in its Arabesque detailed ceilings, walls, domes, and the traditional open gardens and fountains. After lunch, we had a free time to explore the city. Some of us walked around the Jewish quarter, looking at all the shops, and others went to the Plaza de España and rented boats for the afternoon. That night, we returned to the hotel and got ready to leave for Granada the next morning.
We arrived in Granada after experiencing a few days in Sevilla. The first major event in Granada was a guided tour of the city. The most exciting thing we saw was the Asentamiento, an old courtyard in the center of town that was first a trading hub, then a gold warehouse, then a theater, and finally a community living center. After the tour, we ventured up to the Cartuja, a monastery of monks who vowed an oath of silence and ate their meals in the gruesome Hall of Martyrs, which depicts various religious figures dying in the name of the Catholic Church. Then we went to lunch. A large part of Spain's culture are meals, and we got to experience an authentic Arabic-influenced meal in Las Cuevas, or the caves. These caves are historically significant to Granada because of the tunnels that connect them to the Alhambra, so that when the fortress was under attack, they could escape and take refuge, or provide reinforcements.
Shortly thereafter, we trekked up to the Alhambra, a fortress converted into the Sultan's royal palace in 1333. The Alhambra consists of the main living area and courtyard, the ruins of the fortress, and the Generalife, the large and illustrious gardens. The Alhambra is one of the most stunning pieces of architecture in Spain. The walls and columns are hand-carved with prayers in Arabic and intricate geometric patterns, and the view from the living quarters overlooks the rest of Granada. It took ages to work our way through each room, as absorbing and photographing the individual details was time-consuming, but well worth it. As the sun was setting, we made our way out into the gardens, marveling at the number of flowers in full bloom, as well as their amazing smell. We had fun taking pictures and absorbing as much as we could in the few hours that we had. After taking taxis down from the hilltop on which the Alhambra sits, we joined Liz and Jose Mata for a lovely dinner and retired to our rooms shortly thereafter.
Almería is a city in Andalusia located along the coast in the southeast of Spain. This strategic port became a coveted location for ruling parties to occupy and control. However, time and time again in Spanish history, Almería found itself as the last stronghold. Due to its hillside location near the coast, it is positioned perfectly for defending against invaders. A large part of Almería's history centers around the fortress known as La Alcazaba. Construction began during Moorish rule in the 10th century and was built on a hill near the coast so invaders could be seen from miles away. Its location on a cliff overlooking the ocean made it easy to defend from pirates such as Jack Sparrow. La Alcazaba is the second largest fortress in Spain behind La Alhambra, and to this day it has never been conquered. After Ferdinand and Isabel united Spain and Christianity became established, a Christian-style annex was added onto the fortress in the 16th century. The contrast between the Christian and Moorish styles was interesting for us to compare side by side and gave us a deeper understanding of the architectural differences.
Aside from resisting invaders, Almería also resisted domestic threats and was the last city to fall to Franco during the Spanish Civil War. General Franco was a military dictator who ruled from 1939 to 1975. He partnered with the Germans to help him conquer Spain. Soon after the air raid started in Almería, construction began on Los Refugios, an underground tunnel system designed to house up to 35,000 people and to protect them from Franco's bombs. These tunnels ran all throughout the city with entrances that were cleverly disguised so that the German pilots could not bomb weak points in the structure. In total, the refugios are about 4.5 kilometers in length, with large cement pillars throughout that helped to reduce shock waves. The underground refuge also contained a surgery room for tending to the wounded and a food storage room to supply and withstand longer air raids. This superstructure helped Almería to resist Franco during a crucial time in Spanish history and plays an important role in Almería's history. While we were in Almería, we also visited a photo exhibition showcasing the Gitanos, a gypsy ethnic group in Spain. Pierre Gonard is a French photographer that aimed to capture the spirit of the misunderstood Gitanos. He lived with them for months to understand who they were and so he could accurately portray them through his portraits. It was very compelling to see the close-ups of the Gitanos blown up to nearly 5 feet tall. To see such marginalized people on such a large scale really gave a sense for how mistreated the gypsies were in Spain. Some of the stereotypes about gypsies among Spaniards were that they were incapable of working, dishonest, dirty, and because of this, they were marginalized in society. Gonor really captured that although the gypsies were very mistreated, they are just as human as anyone else, and despite being misunderstood, they have a deep sense of pride.
Church in Alicante began at 10 a.m. Sunday morning. When we arrived at the church, the members gave us a warm welcome. The service was conducted in Spanish, and we sang hymns from the Spanish hymnal. In Alicante, every month, the society has a testimony meeting following the Sunday service because it is difficult for some of their members to drive all the way into town on a Wednesday. Attending testimony meeting in Alicante was truly a blessing. Several church members were new to Christian Science and gave testimonies that were incredibly moving, and some students from the abroad even gave their testimonies in Spanish.
After church, we took a tram ride to a gorgeous beach on the outskirts of Alicante called San Juan Beach. At a beachside restaurant, local church members joined us for what would be a 3-hour lunch filled with great conversations and traditional Spanish food. Everyone was hungry by the time we sat down, but we knew the meal would be filling. They started to bring out a continuous stream of dishes, ranging from seafood to paella. After we finished lunch, we had time to explore the never-ending beach before heading to Jose Mata's lecture. Some students walked along the beach, dipped their toes in the water, built sandcastle replicas of the Alhambra, while others jumped into the Mediterranean Sea.
After lunch, we finished the day by attending a Christian Science lecture by José de Dios Mata. The Christian Science movement in Spain is new, but those who are involved are very excited to share their beliefs. When we arrived at the venue, it was packed with people, and throughout the lecture, people kept coming in. Many of those attending were not Christian Scientists, but were very interested in the ideas that José had to share with them. Catholicism is still a very dominant religion in Spain, but people seem a lot more willing to consider other forms of Christianity now. José's talk was entitled Reino de los Cielos, which means the reign of heaven in English. He focused on what it really meant to be living in the kingdom of heaven and emphasized the importance of love in our relationships with one another. This lecture was a good challenge because it gave us a chance to learn more about the teachings of Christian Science while practicing our listening skills in Spanish.
During the week of Alicante, we participated in a musical performance to give back to the community. We worked closely with two church members who were part of an NGO focused on providing free music lessons to interested members of the community. On the night of the performance, everyone helped in some capacity. The Principia students had been rehearsing all week for the concert. Many of the students played instruments or sang songs for the event, including Disney tunes, smooth jazz guitar, and a traditional Spanish Civil War song. There was also a beautiful violin solo by Jesse Dennett. At the end, everybody participated in singing hymns for the crowd. The audience loved it.
One of our final evenings in Alicante was spent visiting the Castillo de Santa Barbara. Set atop a hill with a panoramic view of the city and the ocean, the castle is one of the most recognizable structures in Alicante. We had a private tour guided by the Normay family, our friends from a local Christian Science society. From our tour, we learned that the castle was built during the Moorish era and has since been used for many purposes, including serving as a prison. Our time in Spain went by so quickly. Each successive day yielded new opportunities to learn, new adventures, and new ways to express our theme, Love is Reflected in Love. Liz Mata, our resident counselor for the abroad, once said, "Sometimes on a short trip, when you are faced with some unique cultural differences in food, tradition, communication, and everyday expectations, there is no learning curve. You just have to be who you are as God's child, and include everyone you meet in that same understanding." This type of thinking led to tremendous instances of spiritual and character growth throughout the trip, as well as harmonious interaction with the Spanish people. As students, we would like to thank Principia for giving us this incredible opportunity. We would also like to thank Duncan Charters and Liz and Jose Mata for their dedication to the abroad. I can honestly say that the experiences we had in Spain were life-changing, and I'm sure none of us will ever forget our Spanish journey.